Our responsive reading will be page 596, The Ideal Mother, in the back of your hymnal. We will read responsively. Number 596. Who can find a virtuous woman? Her price is far above rubies.
The heart of her husband does not safely trust in her, so that she shall have no need of war.
She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life.
She seeketh wool and flax, and her work with her women and her friends.
She is like the merchant ships. She bringeth her food from afar.
She rises also upon the dead night, and giveth meat to her household, and portion to her maidens.
She considereth a field, and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands, she planteth a vineyard.
She girdeth her loins with strength, and strengtheneth her arms.
She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor, yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy.
She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for her household goes with sorrow.
She maketh herself covering of tapestry, her clothing is silk and purple.
Her husband is known in the gates, when he sits among the others of the land.
She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness.
She looketh well to the ways of her household, and even not regret her lines.
Her children arise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and praiseth her.
Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all.
Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised altogether. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Amen. Amen. We will have selections from our male chorus.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Brother Percy would like to have a few words.
Good morning. Happy Mother's Day.
Good morning.
On behalf of your trustee board, I'd like to thank you. I feel it in the atmosphere. The spirit of the Lord is here. The spirit of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The power of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here.
Let's say happy Mother's Day to every woman that's here. Come on, you can do it better than that. Happy Mother's Day. We respect the fact that every woman has a womb. Every now and then, we have the opportunity to see a sermon in shoes. And I'm going to comment on what I want to say. I want, if I can, to call Brother Frank, Tertia, and their two children. If you all would just stand here, amen. That's all right, the baby shoe fell. That happens. I want to just, if you all will, I ran into this family. I was getting some blood work because I'm trying not to need a bra when I go to the beach this summer. So I wanted to know what I was working with. And so we have to look at my sermon today. It's going to be short, especially if you all say amen. But I wonder if you all would just come to the mic just for a moment. And this beautiful wife and family, as I was getting my blood work, the phone rang twice, and she went to go get it. And this wonderful young woman, it moved me in such a way, I asked her to come. And I wonder if you will, Sister Tertia, in just 2-3 minutes, share with me what you shared on this week. Introduce your family, please. Isn't there a beautiful family this morning?
Good morning, everyone. My name is Tertia Corsi. This is my husband, Frankie, my daughter, Nyla, and Elijah. It started off me getting him. He's adopted. His mother came from a bad situation, lived in the street life, doing whatever she does out there. So I had to become a foster parent. Becoming a foster parent helped me get him and adopt Elijah. And then later on, Anila came to my job at LabCorp, and she was with a previous foster parent. And she had no interest in adopting Anila, so I decided that I would take her on. But taking Anila took a lot of work because Anila had a bad start to life. At 4 months old, her biological parents beat her real bad, so she has chicken baby syndrome. They took the game system, like a Nintendo game system, and beat her in the head with it. So therefore, she has stroke-like symptoms on her right side. They said she'll never be able to walk. Well, with the help of my husband, doing her exercises with her, and physical therapy at school, she's now able to walk.
Now, two things this morning. I want to just say this. Now, two things. When I heard the story, she was telling me that she had to get the phone. I know the Holy Spirit was working on me already. Because not only is she saying, I'm putting him up front, and it's hard to be up front, the baby was blind. They told her she would never walk or talk. And when I said to this young, I thought that she, you know, too often we are stereotyping and say, this is just another single black mother with her children. But she and her husband adopted a child that most of us would not even want to have if they were born to us. And when I got ready to give her credit, she talked about how her husband is working with this child. Not only can this child walk, she can talk. And through love and mothering, they're making a difference. Come on now, isn't that wonderful? And so guess what? They're looking for a church home, and I told them we got one for them. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. That's really the sermon this morning. A young woman and a young husband came. A mother to a child that had been mistreated. Can we bow, shall we pray? I want to talk about this morning. We can't settle for half. We need whole. Will you help me? Y'all kind of slow this morning. We can't settle for half. We need whole. Now you all say amen. I'm looking for them. They need a church home, and I got one for them too. Lord, we come right now to say thank you. Because you are a wonderful Savior. The Lord, you keep doing miracles. And we don't have, if we can just get out the way, Lord, you would do what you said you would do. On this Mother's Day, speak to our hearts that we may hear from heaven. Amen. So now, really, this morning, I'm going to say thank you all again. I'm just moved by that. My. The text, again, I want you to hear it. The king said, this one says, my son is alive and your son is dead. And while one says, no, your son is dead and mine is alive, the king said, bring me a sword. So they brought a sword for the king. Then he gave an order, cut the living child in two and give half to one and half to the other. Listen to verse 26. The woman whose son was alive was filled with compassion. For her son, she said to the king, please, my lord, give her the living baby. Don't kill him. But listen what the other one said. The other one said, cut him in two. Then the king gave his ruling, give the living baby to the first woman. Do not kill him. She is the mother. She is the mother. Very briefly this morning, I think about the word by the sage Oliver Wendell Holmes when he said, the real religion of the world comes from women much more than from men. From mothers, most of all, who carry the key of our souls in their bosoms. Real religion comes from women. Of course, that was before Frank Corsi got in the scene. Much more than men, from mothers, most of all, who carry the key of souls in their bosom. And of course, you cannot talk about womanhood unless you think about Zora Neale Hurston, who, as folklorist and writer says, mama exhorted her children. Listen to this. At every opportunity, she said, jump for the sun. She knew we might not land on the sun, but at least we would get off the ground. She knew we may not get to the sun, but she at least knew we would get off the ground. And so this morning, we are in need to look at where we are with our children and to encourage mothers, because we're really in need of finding individuals who will be effective as mothers. Why is that? Because every second and a half during the school year, a public school student receives an out-of-school suspension. Why? Because every 8 seconds, a high school student drops out. Why? Because every 17 seconds, a child is arrested. Why? Because every 19 seconds, a baby is born to a mother who will have to struggle all by herself. Why? Because every 40 seconds, a child is abused or neglected. Why? Because every 6 minutes, a child is arrested for a violent offense. Why? Because every 8 hours, a child commits commits suicide. And that leaves our children vulnerable and puts them in a position to fail in life. The National Defense Fund on its website, where those figures come from, also mentions that in the what is called the PISA study, which is the International Student Assessment Test, describes that there are not two Americas, a rich and poor, rather there are four Americas. And in these four Americas, overall, America is 17th altogether, but when you break out the four Americas, you see why we are below what is called industrial countries. Reading in America, Asian students are second behind China and ahead of Korea. White children are seventh behind Singapore and above Canada. Hispanics who've just come really to America are 43rd behind Lithuania and ahead of Turkey. But African American children are 49th behind Serbia and ahead of Bulgaria. Same thing is true in math. Asian children rank 13th, whites 16th, Hispanics 43rd, African American children 52nd, between Uruguay and ahead of Chile. It's true again in science, and really those who are prepared for science are those who will be able to compete in the world. Asians 7th. Whites 9, Hispanics 44th, and African Americans are 52nd. This raises for us a paramount issue that ought to be overwhelming, and this morning I want to say to you that it is not because there's anything genetically wrong. It is not because our children cannot learn. It is not just simply because our children are not in the best of parochial schools. The real issue is this morning that overwhelmingly our children are disaffected or affected, should I say, by poverty, unemployment, ignorance, and most of all, lack of effective mothering. That poverty is not new. Unemployment is not new. Ignorance is not new. But our children cannot make it, and in this month of renewal, we can make it through and over poverty and unemployment and ignorance, but we cannot make it through unless we reinterpret our Christianity. The church has to be more than just coming on Sunday morning. And it has to be more than just dropping our kids off at whatever programs the church has. We've got to have a renewal in our faith. And we must see ourselves as surrogates of children the way Brother Frank and his wife are and have shared with us. That our world has messed our children up. And we have been active participants. I don't need no amen. I got all I need this morning. That this morning, I've noticed that when my son watches Godfather, my son watches wrestling, they have this white wrestler called Godfather, who is nothing but a caricature pimp. That this wrestler, I don't even know his name. My son showed him to me last night. And my little daughter was singing the song called I Was Born in the Gutter. Then my son said on the other side, yeah, mama got the butter. That if we allow social media and if we allow the caricatures of images for African American children to be raised by TV and social media and even popular culture, our children are finished. That we must re-engineer something that is not new, but something that we've gotten away from. And that is effective parenting, which almost and exclusively in many instances ends up being effective mothering. That we cannot, as much as we may want to blame daddy who may or may not be there, that is not new. Unfortunately, when African-American men are underemployed and unemployed, they're so depressed that if they're not a blessing in the home, they're usually a burden. And that the worst thing that our children can experience is not having a home where a father is not there. The worst thing in the world is our children growing up in a home where there's not some adult who cares about their long-term development. So what we need this morning, and why I'm so moved, and I'm so glad the courses are with us, is that despite what we face, and despite what the projections are for our children, if we get a new kind of Christianity, and if we engage in a selfless, not selfish, motherhood that is accompanied with more interest in the child's long-term development, the child's well-being, we will be able to transform our children into well-developed children that through nurture, love, and the right kind of Christianity will allow our children to overcome all the obstacles and go from the bottom to the top. But now, how did we get here? I'm not going to be long this morning. You get dead, I will. I'm not preaching to a white church. You all black, aren't you? But what has happened this morning is we have allowed ourselves to get lost in this culture. Can I tell you, not long ago, when I was a child, these little women on Tuesday saw a Kaighn commercial, and there they were with those shoes that I associated with wisdom of old black women as they had aprons on doing Bible study. And I heard Mother Bell say something. She said, if young women buy into that, the Kaighn commercial, I'm not the oldest in here. She got in the tub and she said, Kaighn, take me away. Mother Bird, not Bell, Mother Bird said that if young women buy into that, not only will they lose their husbands, they're going to lose their home. I didn't know what that meant, but that was way before Atlanta Housewives. Can I preach for just a few moments? That was before Hip Hop Love Atlanta, where folk want to live lavishly and their job is lunching and breaking out into Negro madness. And so we, thank you, Mother Bird, bless your heart, who understood with an apron on cooking, not for children, but for children of the neighborhood that she watched as their mothers were working and did not leave the children home on their own because they were too young to have a key. And she knew with her third grade education that if they didn't have the right nurture at home, that an empty mind is a devil's workshop. That they needed some wise, sagacious, loving mother to be waiting on them and and to keep them in the straight and narrow and help them do their homework until mommy and daddy got home. She had no idea that there would be these folk who want to sit around in SUVs and wear big rings. And children are nothing more than something to have a baby shower around and try to get child support. It's quiet in here. We, these mothers, these women, who were no better married than we, who did not make the money we made, in many instances, a fraction of the income. Yes, yes. Whose husbands, whose children disappointed them just as you. Found ways not to be overwhelmed by life. Yes. Yes. We're not angry because they had been left, as we may call, with the bag. Who realized that the children needed them more than some man. Who made sacrifices to make sure that the children were able to go as far in life as they could and did everything they could to get them in position so that when they were adults, they would be able to reach their fullest potential. Who understood that getting your groove on with the bum of the month is not enough for a child. That the trade-off was, I'm going to put everything I can in this child's mind, heart, and life so that they will excel. And so finally this morning, they understood, coming from the deep south, being in relationships that perhaps they would have wanted more, they did not identify with victimization. Rather, they moved towards victory and valor. And so most of us in here, our mothers were not perfect, but thank God they understood that our children's minds are sponges. And the greatest thing that most of us will quote will not be a college professor. It will be what mama said and done. So down the text this morning and I'm finished. The text first of all tells us that Solomon, who was the son of David, God came to him at night and said, Solomon, what do you want? Good God Almighty. What do you want, Solomon? I suspect if many of us ask by God, what do we want? Lord, I want him 6'5". You got to have a six pack. I want his head real shiny and bald. I want him to get me a big ring. Solomon did not ask God for stuff because stuff doesn't matter. Solomon said, God, if I'm going to lead your people, that's what mothers ought to be asking this morning. Lord, if I'm going to be an effective mother, if I'm going to have to be the one that will set in place the model for my children, despite the neighborhood, the community, the relationship with this father, Lord, give me wisdom. Yes. Since I can't change how much money I have, give me wisdom so I know what to buy. Yes. I don't have that much money. I'm not going to go get steak and barbecue chips. You might as well say amen. I'm going to figure out, as my mother said, how to buy some food to make it stretch. So the children can have a good meal every day. Give me wisdom. I'm not dead as I prepare to date, that I bring men around that will not taunt my children or destroy my children or sexually abuse my children. Give me wisdom.
That when I go to the school, I don't come there looking crazy, cussing the teacher out, but trying to find out how I can help this child learn and do well in life. Lord, give me wisdom. Help me pick what church I need to attend so I can find good preaching and good teaching and good role models for my children. Lord, give me wisdom. There's not a man in the house. Help me find an uncle. Help me find a good brother from the church or the neighborhood who will be a good father or a good male figure for my boys. Give me wisdom. Do I need to get a tattoo? No. Because I don't want them thinking that looking like some woman on a bar stool is a model for a wife. Give me wisdom. Do I need to have my breast showing every time I go out? No. Because I want them to know that a good mother has more on the inside than she shows on the outside. Give me wisdom. Give me wisdom that if I'm a single mother, that I understand that I can't pick a husband like maybe the way I picked the first one. Can we be real? Looks all right, but I need somebody to pay bills. Like to come home at night. Help me, Holy Ghost. Will be a good father figure. Am I right about that? That the children will see respectability and decency. Give me wisdom. But now this text gives us the juxtaposition of what happens and what can happen. And the first point I like is that the text gives us a real example, because it says, and I'm glad it says it, these are not two high society women. You know, in church, sometimes we get so high and holy, we forget that we don't live on Hallelujah Boulevard. Most of us try to keep on Lord Have Mercy. And so it said two harlots, two prostitutes. And so the Lord gives us an example that we can't say, well, I'm not there. It gives us an example that identifies with the worst case scenario. Yeah. Now, I like that because I hate to say it, but African Americans make too many excuses. And the problem with excuses, even if they are legitimate, you empower yourself to stay where you are. And can I tell you, I don't care where you are, I don't care what you're dealing with, I don't care what you're going through, I love the Word of God, because God always has pertinent examples to tell you there is a way out. I don't care if you're on welfare, I don't care if you messed up in life, I don't care if you've not been a good mother in your past, I'm telling you, today is a new day. And you have no excuses to stay where you are. God has forgiven you for your past, and He is expecting better from you from this day forward. Help me, Holy Ghost. Can you say hallelujah? Hallelujah. Don't we serve a God that's wonderful, who gives us a fifth chance, a thousandth chance, a million chance to get it right and get it together one more time? Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. So now, so the text zeroes in. And it says that there were two women of ill repute. And it doesn't say whether they love the daddy or not. Let me pause right there and say, Frederick Douglass probably was the victim of rape
Now, how do I know that? We men like white women, but you all black women like them bigger and black. They tell me light ain't in no more. So Frederick Douglass's mother was no doubt raped. But now, even with that, you got to hear this. His mother worked in the field. Now you're talking about on your feet. I said in the field. And after being in the field, had a baby from probably rape. Yet two or three times a week, she walked 8 to 11 miles to hold her little baby for a few hours, knowing she would be back in the field in the morning, and if she was late, she could be whipped to death. So now I'm telling you, it don't even make a difference who the daddy is. See, we got all these excuses because whoever he was, in most cases, it wasn't rape. In most cases, it probably was put on them. That's the clean version. But it doesn't even make a difference because that's your child. And the fact that that is your child means that you are responsible. But now this text tells us something right quick, and I learned this when my son was born. Listen to this. The text said that they had babies within 3 days of each other. And a mother knows her child's cry. But even worse than that, the text says that one of the mothers rolled over on her own baby. Now, I'm tell y'all some of my business, and Kathy's here. When my son was born, Kathy made a mistake and put him in the middle. And I almost rolled over on him. Now, Kathy's not Baptist. She's real Catholic. If I could give you the words, she called me for almost. Can I get a witness in here for rolling over on a baby? But the text says she rolled over on her own child. In other words, that tells me she smothered her baby because she had a lack of interest and concern. Minister Martin can tell you that Dyfus is filled with mothers who the biggest challenge to them is they roll over and smother their own children because of lack of interest and concern, that they are absent in nurture and connection. What do you mean? I mean that too many of our children are smothered because mama is not emotionally connected. Smothered because we are not concerned about our children's well-being. There's no reason why. I don't care what job you work, how many jobs you work, that you don't cook for your children two or three times a week. Amen, Pastor. Pause for a moment. The man found a McDonald's hamburger. Google it today. He had preserved it for 10 years. And the only thing that had decomposed was the pickle. Now, anybody who would give their children McDonald's hamburgers 3 or 4 times a week without a vegetable, and it did not decompose in 10 years, that may be the reason why our children look like balloons.
concerned about our children's well-being. Took children yesterday, and I'm learning my own self that we must be connected to our children, even those of us who try to take our children to the park. We're at the park swinging our children on the cell phone. Children playing. Rather than us playing with them, we talking to somebody ain't about nothing. Yeah. I'ma claim that by faith. Yeah. Emotionally not connected, not concerned about their well-being. In other words, we don't read to our children. We don't cook for our children. We don't make time for their emotional connection. We don't make sure that we help them with their work, whether we know how to do it or not. But we spend so much time watching TV and being online, yes, that we've allowed the television to become a two-bit babysitter that fills our children's minds with craziness. And so forget everybody else. Thank God for the courses this morning, because to be a mother, you don't even have to be biologically the mother. You can be the grandmother. You can be the aunt. You can be the person down the door, down the street, rather. But now listen, I'm finished. So they went with their concerns to Solomon. And the Bible says he was a repository of wisdom. And the first example of his wisdom is he uses it on children. Good God Almighty. I'm going to tell you, my son tried to throw away some food. And he did the same thing I tried. He tried to put it right on top, under a napkin. And I knew he would do that because I had tried the same thing. And he didn't know I had the wisdom to know that the same way he tried it, I tried. And you know, it's never the sweet stuff. It's always the vegetables. I said, you've got to have wisdom. Now, the text says that they came before Solomon. And you know, people are bold today. They know they'll be as wrong as 15 left shoes, but they'll come before you anyway. One smothered the baby. The other loved the baby. And so Solomon, with his wisdom, listen what he says. Let's cut the baby in half. And many of us, we're all right with half a man. Half a woman. Help me, somebody. Half. But this mother understood that half is always less than whole. The mother said, I'd rather see my baby alive, away from me, whole. Another mother said, I don't care. My baby already dead. I just let both of us be, both those children be dead. And Solomon then said, nah, she must be the real mother. Because real mothers want children to be whole. Oh, bless his holy name. Now, let me tell you, there's not a conspiracy on you, but you've got to be part of a conspiracy. It just hit me Tuesday. I was saying to my Tuesday class that I'm part of a conspiracy. And the last time I was home, a fellow in my church named Michael Hester. His whole family joined my father's church, and it was a ghetto family. Well, the church is in a ghetto area. Everybody would come to church in house slippers. Ghetto family. But the mother was a good woman, and the children was faithful to their mother, and their father was a slick guy and always trying to get over. But now, I'm going to tell you, the last time I went home, I saw Michael Hester. It was Michael who had been abused in childhood. Michael, who went
to the worst middle school in the city. Michael, who went to church, started off with house slippers on, getting very poor grades. But that's not the Michael I saw. Michael had a college degree. Michael had a two-piece suit on. Michael was holding his two children under his arms. And I had to stop and tell Michael and say, Michael, we got to thank the Lord, because when you came here, you didn't have anything, but old women who were not your mother took you under their wings and got you clothes and got you church shoes and helped you with your schoolwork, and they decided they were going to make something out of you, and they did it. Praise God. Praise God. That's the job of the church. Find children that's messed up.